Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text this morning is the gospel lesson as written in the 8th chapter of John, and our theme this morning, hold firm to the truth of the word. Please be seated. Dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, well, it's been 499 years. 499 years ago, an Augustine monk, a friar and professor, nailed 95 theses onto the castle church door in Wittenberg, Germany. There, on those theses, he was protesting the selling of indulgences, the selling of a slip of paper that would guarantee that your loved one or you yourself would spend less time in purgatory. Luther had realized that the church had lost her focus. She was more concerned with money, with worldly things, rather than being focused upon her heavenly bridegroom, her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That central truth, dear ones, is being lost in the church even today. There truly is, as Solomon tells us, nothing new under the sun. Sadly, many churches today rarely even mention the name of Jesus, let alone that he is their atoning sacrifice, let alone that he was the one who died upon his cross, was placed in a tomb, and rose again on the third day, let alone the fact that he ascended into heaven, and there he stands at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and for me, and that he is returning, but he can't return until the millennium comes, and that there's 7 years of tribulation. You see, he's confined in heaven. You see, Jesus can't be present here to serve you his body and blood because he's a man. And since he's a man, he can't leave heaven. These are the false teachings that still permeate our church today, the church of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see, as it was in Luther's time, it is today. There are people who use the church for their own glorification, or they use the church for their own comfort, or they use the church to get rich at the expense of the congregants. So this morning, dear Zion, you will not hear about a Christless church, nor will you hear about a feel-good Jesus. You will not hear that Jesus is just a good moral teacher. You will not hear that Jesus is your boyfriend or your best friend, or even more disgustingly, your lover. No, today you will hear about Jesus Christ and who he is and what he has done for you, and that he proclaims to you today, hold firm to the truth. Hold firm to the truth of the word. The truth that comes from Christ Jesus himself. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. Before Jesus stands two groups of people stood before him then, two groups stand before him today, and two groups will stand before him on the great last day. Before Jesus will stand the believer to his right, and the unbelievers to his left. So Jesus speaks a message. He speaks the same message that he spoke then, today, and that he will speak again on Judgment Day. And that message is for everyone. There are no exceptions. His word is for the believer and for the unbeliever. What Jesus says is the truth. What he says is the fact. A truth for each and every person who says that to believe. The truth is this. Jesus says, if you are a true disciple, if you are a true believer, if you are a true learner, a true student, you will abide, you will remain in my word. Not the word of other people, not the word of the evil one, not the words of the world. You will remain in his word alone. A true disciple of Jesus will continue in his teachings, in his word. Literally, a true disciple of Jesus will abide, hold fast, cling to Jesus and his word. A true disciple will hold so fast and will cling to his gift so hard, so lovingly, that they'll never ever let them go. This reminds me of a child. I hope, Mom and Dad, you've never done this. Maybe brother or sister has done this, though. They give their little brother or sister a toy or a piece of candy, and then they try to take it away from them. What does that little child do? He will refuse, or she will refuse, to let go. She will hold on to it so hard that it's almost impossible to get it out of her hand. If they are finally overpowered, oh, they will let you know. They will certainly let you know that they are very, very, very unhappy. You see, today in the church there are disciples. Yet within Christendom itself, there are very few disciples of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There are the true disciples present here this morning. Each of you have been brought here by the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, it wasn't your car. It wasn't your idea. It was actually the Holy Spirit who brought you here so that you will hear the word, so that you will receive the word in body and in blood, so that you will hear the importance of your baptism, so that you will hear about the importance of the means of grace. That's why you are here this morning. You are here because you are a true disciple. And a true disciple will always want to be in the presence of their teacher, of their Lord, of their God, of their Savior. Dearest brothers and sisters, just saying that you are a Christian, though, isn't enough. You can't claim the title of Christian and then walk away from him, let go of the gifts that he gives to you. If you just, unlike the child, just freely give away all the gifts that he gives to you, you have forfeited the right to say that you are a Christian. If you stop remembering your baptism, if you stop worshiping in spirit and in truth, if you never come to his altar to partake of his body and blood, if you never hear the preached word, by the way, doesn't Scripture tell us faith cometh by hearing and hearing the word of Christ? Sounds pretty clear to me. A true disciple knows. A true disciple knows where he or she will hear the words of Jesus, where they will receive from Jesus his most precious gifts, his means of grace. A true disciple will have faith. Just like that little child, they will hold on, hold so fast that it can never be removed from them. It can never be taken from them. Jesus promises you that you will never be taken from his hand. Therefore, why would a Christian want to let go? You see, the truth is this. The truth is, as Jesus tells us this morning, that the truth sets us free. But since some people think that they're free, they're not truly free because they're really slaves. They're really slaves to sin. Jesus tells us, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, the Jews, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say we will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Amen, amen. I say to you, Everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. Dear ones, Jesus is the truth. It doesn't matter what your teacher tells you in school or your professor or what the world says to you. Jesus is the truth. It's not your truth, it is Him. He is the truth. He is not a philosophic truth. He is not a transcending truth. He is not some vapor out there, floating through the ethos, floating through the air. No, He is a tangible, real, personal truth, a living human being, the God-man, who is your truth. For He is the one, not an angelic being. He is not just a normal human being. No, He is not a dreamed-up person or a dreamed-up thought. Only Jesus the God-man, is your truth. Only Jesus is the one who went to the cross, who was nailed here for your sin and my sin. There is no other man who is willing to sacrifice himself so that you and I could live. He is the truth, and the truth sets you free. Since Jesus has done this great work for each of you, you truly have been set free. You have been baptized and set apart by the power of the Holy Spirit, who reveals to your heart and mind the truth that you have peace with God, that you yourself have been reconciled to God, that it is His work done for you there at the font. It wasn't your decision. It was His decision to come to you and to give you newness of life, to wash away all your sin. It is He who gives you spiritual peace. It is He who allows you to come before your Father in heaven and to live. Because God has done this great work for you, this great work of justification and sanctification, you have been changed. Dear ones, you are no longer of the world. Oh, you live in the world, but you're not of the world. You have been set apart. You have been made special. Unlike the Jews, you have actually been set apart by the power of God. For you believe what He has done for you, and you cling to it. You hold fast to it. You will never let it go. Yet, unbelief does respond to truth. It responds with lies. The unbelievers who answered Jesus in our text this morning, they were very emphatic in denying that they were ever slaves any time in their lives. Yet they were slaves. It should have been obvious to us that they were slaves in Egypt. They were slaves in Assyria and in Babylon and in Persia and in Greece and now in Rome. So if they thought they were politically free, they're liars. So therefore they must think that they're spiritually free. Yet, why did they go into captivity? Because they worshipped other gods, or they made themselves a god. They were liars. And it's the same way today. People on the outside, they look very godly, but on the inside, they are a tomb. Jesus says to the Pharisees that they are whitewashed tombs. We have the same in the church today. On the inside, people are rotten to the core. They refuse to hear the word. They refuse to come here and partake of His body and blood. They refuse to remember their baptism. Oh, they look nice, and people say that they're a good person or she's a good lady. But on the inside, they are dead, dead, dead. And these are the very people. These are the very people who want to justify themselves before you. They want to show you that they're better than you. Yet they are never here to partake of any of the gifts given to them freely by their Lord and given to you freely by your Lord. These are the very people who proclaimed to Jesus, "We are not sinners. No, we are not like the Gentiles. We are not like those rotten tax collectors. We are not like those sinners who eat with your master Jesus," as they proclaimed to the disciples. "You see, we're special ones." They truly believed, dear ones, that they were saved because of who they are, because of their lineage, because they were descendants of Abraham, because they're special, the children of God, the nation of Israel. And it's the same in the church today. There are people who believe that they're automatically saved once they're confirmed. They no longer need church. They no longer need to hear the preached word. They no longer need this precious gift here upon the altar. They walk away. They think they're special. They think they've got it. They think because they're Lutheran, they'll automatically be in heaven. Well, we have another word for them. Hypocrite. They are hypocrites, just like the Pharisees, just like the scribes and the chief priest and the priest. They are whitewashed tombs. They look nice on the outside, but on the inside, once again, they are dead, dead, dead. So Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin." This is the dreadful, dreadful consequence of disobedience to God's law and to His word. It's a final judgment, a solemn truth that will never, ever be altered. Jesus has no particular class in mind. It doesn't matter, dear friends, if you are a Jew, if you're an American, if you're from Ohio, if you're a Lutheran, if you're from Indiana, or even if you're a member of Zion. Everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. Jesus affirms the reality of our original sin, as you have heard in the epistle lesson this morning. The consequences of our sin is death, spiritual alienation from God forever and ever in hell. Sin isn't just doing the deed, dear ones. It's actually a wrong condition of the heart. It's by thought, word, and deed that we sin against our God. And when we sin against our God and refuse to confess our sins, we refuse to hear the absolution. We think we are self-righteous and sin doesn't touch us any longer because I've been confirmed, or I'm a Christian, or I'm a Lutheran. That, dear ones, are words of death. We sin daily and we sin much. You sin and I sin. Rather, I am the chief of sinners. You've heard that before, and it's true. We are all so, so corrupt. We are corrupt to the core that we don't even realize that we are sinning. As you sat there, you sin. And when I leave this pulpit, I will be sinning, because of the thoughts that I have in my heart and mind. The same with you. We break His commandments daily and much. We especially like to think that we're better than the person sitting next to us, or in front of us, or behind us. We want to idolize ourselves. Why, I'm a Lutheran, and I'm in church every Sunday. Yet, how do I treat my spouse, or my children, or my neighbors? How do I talk with my friends? What do I think of my neighbors? Do I have a bad habit of spreading gossip? Do I covet everything of my neighbors? Do you murder in your heart? Do you steal in your heart? Do you dishonor your mother and father? This morning, dear ones, you are hearing the law. And we must hear the law. We must hear the law directly from our Lord, as Jesus proclaimed the law to these Jews standing before them. He proclaims the law so your heart and my heart will be made ready to hear the sweetness and the truth of His holy gospel. The truth, my friends, leads us to sonship. It leads us to be heirs of the kingdom. Jesus tells us that the slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Jesus says that unless you are set free from the slavery to sin, you will have no lasting place in the house. You will have no lasting place in the kingdom of God. Yet it is the Son. It is the Son who has come. It is the Son who is the worthy one and who has made you worthy by taking your sin unto himself. He who knew no sin became sin for us, and he took those sins, your sin and my sin, every single one of them that we have committed, that we're committing now, and that we will commit in the future. He has taken them here, and he's nailed them to a cross. He is the worthy Son who was put to death by his Father to fulfill the plan of salvation for you and for me. This is what Jesus has freed you from the effects of your sin, eternal death in hell with the evil one. Therefore, since Jesus has done this great work, you are no longer a slave to sin. You have been freed from the effects of eternal death. And Satan has no power over you. Use the word. Use that sword of the Spirit, and the devil will flee from you. You see, my friends, the Son has justified you. And as the Son hung here upon his throne, he lifted his head and he shouted, "It is finished!" And he meant it. Your sin is put away. And in faith you believe. You abide. You cling. You hold fast to the truth that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. And there is none other. This is the greatest article of the faith, dear ones, as Luther proclaims to us. The article of justification. That you have been set free by the Son. That you have been justified by grace alone, in faith alone, by Christ alone. You have inherited. You are now an inheritor of the kingdom of heaven. It is yours as a free gift for the Son. Yes, the Son of God, the very Son of God, has set each and every one of you free. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.